Well, good morning, everybody. It's time to begin. Laura told you three guys to break it up. There you go. It's good to see everybody here today, and those of you who are worshiping with us online, we appreciate you being here with us today as we come to worship the Lord. A couple of quick announcements I want to just kind of highlight from the newsletter. Some of you know that many people in our church are involved in a ministry called Manna. It is a ministry that takes food out to homebound individuals every day. And we've got several people in our church that help with that. Every year about this time, we take up a special offering for that, and we will be doing that next Sunday. So I just want to kind of give you a week ahead of time. But one of the biggest things I also want you to notice in your bulletin is something called Hanging of the Greens. We've changed our schedule. Not mean that we have anybody called Green that we're going to hang, but what it is, and somebody told me the other day, this church has always thought just when we decorated we were hanging of the greens. No, this is a special worship service that will be the Sunday night after Thanksgiving for the whole church in the sanctuary. We will get this part in here decorated, but that Sunday night we will have a meal here at 4:30. Or 4 o'clock, and then we will move into the sanctuary. And when you move in there, there will be very minimal amount of decorations that would have been done. And we actually decorate the sanctuary as we work our way through the service. There will be scripture readings that tie in with what we're decorating, and we will have songs. It's just a beautiful way to begin the season. I've not done it since I've been here, but this year we've decided to do it. We didn't get to have much of a Christmas last year, and every church I've ever served, we brought this. So this year, we're finally going to do it here. Some of you have already agreed to be readers, but you're going to be here, and we're going to need readers. We're going to need people that actually help put up the stuff in the service. So please be willing to help us with that, and I promise you won't be disappointed. Because it is a gorgeous service. How many of you have ever actually been to a Hanging of the Green service? All right, they're really pretty, aren't they? I'll never forget, I'd never seen one till years ago when a guy named Jack Mosley, some of y'all may know him, was our choir director and youth director at Bellevue Methodist many years ago. And I remember coming in there one Sunday and there was all these strings hanging up. I'm like, what is he doing? But as the service progressed, we thought, man, it was gorgeous. So I hope that y'all will, even if you don't normally come to an evening service, get a ride if you can't drive at night. But I hope that everybody in this church will be come and be part of that. Are there any other announcements that we need to make before we begin worship? Well, again, it's great to see all of you here today and for all of you joining with us. And let's begin our service with prayer. Precious Heavenly Father, we just come before your grace today, and we ask that by the power of your Holy Spirit, you would make yourself known to us in this place. Open up all of our senses to experience you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Let's stand together this morning and sing and worship.
Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God speaks. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. I'm finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise. All that I need is to be with you, out in the quiet. You pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Would you pour to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Bread, his blood, the wine, broken and poured out, all for love. The whole earth trembled, and the veil was torn. Love so Emmanuel. rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah.
Join me now in the historic Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. On the third day, he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, was seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Father, we just need to stop for a minute to praise your holy name. For grace, it transforms us even when we fail you. You are so awesome and so good to us, and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. This past Thursday was Veterans Day. I think we still kind of get that confused in America. We have Memorial Day for veterans who have given their lives years ago, but we also have Veterans Day this time of year because we want to honor the men and women of our armed forces who gave of their time and effort when they could have been doing something else, to serve our country and to protect us. And I don't know about y'all, but in the last few years, I have been appalled that our veterans have not been respected as they should be. And so, therefore, today, we're going to take a little longer than we normally do. We have a little bitty gift that we want to present our veterans, a little pen that says honored veteran. But today I'm going to call out the name of the part of our armed forces, and if you served in that, would you please stand up, tell your name. Like, I admit I don't know as much about it as y'all would, but battalion or branch, once I name out the branch of service, where you served, whether you were intelligence or mechanic or whatever you were. And then we have some people that want to present you with a pen. The U.S. Coast Guard. Anybody? United States Army. If one of you stand at a time, just tell us. Where did you serve? Thank you, sir. Anyone else for the Army? Well, if y'all would, we're going to do all the applause together. Anyone else for Army? United States Navy? Tim, you'll tell us.
Hawkins, I did just short of 9 years, from 77 to 86, stationed in Virginia on USS Independence aircraft carrier.
All right. United States Marines? And United States Air Force. Stephen, if you'll tell us where you served.
Yeah, General. I was spent 26 years in the active Air Force and 20 years in the Ohio Air National Guard. I was in Strategic Air Command, worked on B-52s, 89s. Was in Okinawa and Thailand during 1968, so you've got a good idea what our planes were doing there.
Yes.
and in the Air National Guard. I worked on A7s, avionics, KC-135s, Rs, avionics, and we supported a lot of the activities that were going on in the Middle East all the way up through when I got out in 2004.
And Rex?
I did radar maintenance in Riverside, California. Went to Guam in Alaska. They worked on the radar in the B-47s and the 135 refueling planes.
Thank you, sir. Anyone else that I've missed? Now, I would like to ask our congregation, the rest of you that serve, to please remain seated. But the rest of us, let us stand and give them an action of appreciation. We thank you for your service, and we appreciate you. And now let us pray. Almighty and merciful God, we thank you for these individuals that you have given us in our church, but also across this country, men and women who gave of their time and their effort and put themselves in harm's way for us. Lord, in many ways, as I thought about today, it reminds me of a really a good example of what Jesus talked about when he talked about sacrifice and service. And to know put themselves in harm's way for us also reminds us of how you gave of yourself on the cross of Calvary for us. Lord, I pray that our country will come to respect and honor these persons as it once did. And Lord, may our country do right by them. Lord, we pray that you would bring our country back to an understanding of who is in control and who calls the shots, who gave of himself that our country might not just have a political freedom, but spiritual freedom, because your Son, Jesus Christ, died on that cruel cross. Forgive us, Lord, when we have taken that spiritual freedom or even the freedom we have in this country for granted. Help us, Lord, as a country to strive to protect it, to stand up against those who would want to do away with Christianity, for those that would seek to change what you brought about long ago. God, we know our country is not perfect, and we have done some wrong things. But forgive us, O God, and help our country to become more and more like you would have it to be. Lord, we praise you for what you're doing in each and every one of our lives, and we thank you for that. And God, we also thank you that every Sunday we have an opportunity to lift up names of people for which we have concern, rather than just putting it in a bulletin and forgetting about it. And so, Lord, part of an active prayer is to literally lift up those names to the God who hears those prayers. And so, Lord, this morning, I want to open up this prayer time for that very purpose, that my brothers and sisters can lift up the concerns of their hearts today.
The family of Kathy Logan.
Craig Pruitt still recovering from pneumonia after recovering from COVID.
My mother Gail Smith, is she rehabs and recovers from knee surgery?
I'm Suzanne and Gail Chambers.
Jerry Reeves, Joanne Littleton,
Brent Elma Bond,
Doug Hood,
Paul F. Howell, Tony Lumpkin, and Larry and Shelby Hawkins,
Jason Milton.
Any others?
Carlene Bryant.
Lord, I also want to lift up Dr. Chip Griffith, who's having to start back chemo, and pray that that will go well. And Lord, we continue to lift up our precious Gail to you. Lord, we know that these last two chemos have really taken her down, and it's been difficult. But Lord, just strengthen her. And Lord, I want to pray for Evelyn and Jimmy Owens. I pray, God, that her recovery will continue and that they will be back to be able to join us again. Now, Lord, we're about to move into the time of the service where I bring the message. Lord, you know how you planted this idea in me earlier the week. And I just pray that you will be the one that speaks through my mouth. You will be the one that transports the message to the ears of my brothers and sisters, and that they would hear the message in the intent that it has. We ask this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. A couple of weeks ago, or 3 weeks ago now, when Brother Terry preached, he kind of opened it by saying something along the lines of, y'all, this is not going to be a lovey-dovey sermon. Sometimes when the Lord puts stuff on your heart, you just have to go with it. So all I can say, as I've said before, buckle up, buttercup. The text today is Ephesians 5, 25 through 27. And you husbands must love your wives with the same love Christ shown the church. And here's the part I really want to emphasize. He, meaning Jesus, gave up his life for her to make her holy and clean, washed by baptism and God's word. He did this to present her to himself as a glorious church without spot or wrinkle or any other blemish. Instead, that she might be holy and without fault. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I want you to think about the people that you love the dearest in your life for a minute. Whether it's your spouse, your children, your parents, friends. And suppose they were desperate for a blood transfusion and you had the same kind of blood. Would you give them some blood so that they might live? What if it was a kidney? What if both of their kidneys were shutting down and they had to have one to survive and you were a match? Would you be willing to give up one of your kidneys, which could make you susceptible to getting sick or maybe dying later on? Would you be willing to risk your life to save somebody you loved? Hopefully all of us would do that. And that is what Paul is talking about that Jesus did for his church. He begins first by talking about family relationships. He talks about, he talks about how women should treat their husbands, but then he gets to the part about how husbands should treat their wives. And he uses Jesus and the church as an example. And he said that relationship that he's talking about between Jesus and his church is what I want us to think about. I want us to think about the fact that Jesus gave up his life for the church. Now, I thought that Jesus gave up his life for all sinners. Right? But what we have to understand is Paul is simply saying when he talks about Jesus and his church, he's talking about all of those who would ever accept Jesus. All sinners who would ever accept Jesus Christ. He's talking about the church with a big C. The true spiritual church that expands the globe and expands time since it came into being at Pentecost. Paul is not talking about universalism. Remind you of what that is. Universalists believe that Christ died, yes, for all sinners, but in the end, even if you hated Jesus, you rejected Jesus, you turned away from Jesus, that in the end, you will be saved. That is not biblical. What Paul is telling us, that Jesus gave himself so that through faith in his sacrifice, we would become part of something that is way bigger than we are. And what are we talking about? Paul talks about the church being the bride of Christ. Jesus hinted at that in several places where he spoke about in Matthew 22 and Matthew 25. But I want to hear you to listen to this text that is an exciting text from Revelation, verses 19, 6 through 9. Then I heard again what sounded like a shout of a huge crowd, the roar of mighty ocean waves, the crash of loud thunder. Hallelujah! The angel said, "For the Lord our God reigns. Let us be glad and rejoice and honor him. For the time has come for the wedding feast of the Lamb, and his bride has prepared herself. She is permitted to wear the whitest fine linen." This linen represents the good deeds done by the people of God. And the angel said this, write this, blessed are those who are invited to the wedding feast of the Lamb. These true words come from God. Folks, if you are a Christian, you are part of the bride of Christ. And there will be a time, sometime in the future, of a great celebration where all Christians of all time, all the saints of the New Testament, and even those who had faith in God, through faith in God, would still be attached to the cross. We will all gather together to celebrate the Lord Jesus Christ. So the church, in a spiritual sense, is the bride of Christ, but in a physical sense, it is the body of Christ. That is the other metaphor used in the Bible. That means we are the hands and the feet and the mouthpiece. So spiritually, we're the bride of Christ, but physically, we are the body of Christ. And that's what we're going to be focusing on more today. So why does the church exist? When I think about our denomination and the issues we are having, I think that we have lost an understanding of the why the church exists. Does the church only exist to address social issues like poverty and to only say that Jesus was a good teacher like other good teachers? And those that focus on that only tend to say that they really don't believe that Jesus was the Son of God, that instead he was merely a good person that God loved, and so we should follow his example. And so therefore we have churches that push feeding programs and clothing programs and all sorts of outreach stuff, but we very seldom talk about anybody accepting Jesus Christ. Because after all, if he's not the Son of God, why should we talk about people accepting him? So, and our denomination is declining because we don't know why we exist and we don't know who Jesus is. And folks, I want to ask you some questions, and I hope that you'll say out loud what you think. Was Jesus just another good teacher? Was Jesus a mere human being that only said good things, that he died and was never heard of again? Was Christ created by God and therefore was not eternal? Is he one of many ways to heaven? Or is he the only way to heaven? So, I think it's sad that the church no longer knows its purpose and no longer knows who Christ is, especially when given what Paul said about how much Christ loves his church. So why does it exist? That's what we're going to talk about, but I'm going to move it closer. Why does this church exist? Why did a man, and I want to give you a little history lesson some of you may not know. Sam, what's the name of the classroom you meet in? Which is the classroom you meet in? Yeah. L.A. Waits. Do y'all know who L.A. Waits was? L.A. Waits was a member of Central Methodist Church that is now known Christ Central. L.A. Waits saw things going on in Rainbow City and said, we need a Methodist church there. So L.A. Waits bought up 4 acres of land right down here at the crossroads of 77 and Rainbow Drive, and Central Methodist Church began to make a church here in Rainbow City. So what's interesting is our mother church is really right down the road from us. And why did he do that? Did he do that so that Rainbow City could have a social club? I mean, after all, they already had a country club around here, right? Did he set it up so that it would just be a group of people meeting with no purpose or no idea? No, they knew a church, Methodist church, was needed here to reach more people for Christ, which reminds me that the first thing that this church exists for is to reach people for Jesus Christ. Now, take out your bulletin. What does it say our mission is? You know, I almost think we need to tweak that. Yes, we're making disciples already. Some of us are growing in our faith. That's part of discipleship. But you know what? We need to insert the word new in there. Our mission is to bring new people to come to know Jesus Christ. We all know, if you've grown up in the church, you've heard the Great Commission a lot. Go and make disciples. Well, part of that, the go part, is the part we're really good at in most Methodist churches. Jesus even mentioned it before he ascended into heaven. He told the disciples, go. And like other United Methodist churches, our church is good at the go part. And so when we think about our church and why it exists, we have to realize that we go because of a reason. Partly and selfishly, some of us in this room may die within the next 15 to 20 years. And if we don't bring new people into this church, then it will die. But most importantly, even bigger than that, is if a people call Christians at Rainbow City don't reach out in love, how will a hurting world even know that God loves them? It says God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. So one of the reasons why we meet each week is not to have a little family reunion, but is to show the love of God. We're pretty good about that. We do some outreach things. We're pretty good about that. But secondly, we exist to win new people for Christ. I want you to think about it. It says, go and make disciples. And then Jesus says, baptizing them. You know what that represents? For adult and youth, it means they have been converted. They've accepted Jesus Christ. Jesus told the disciples in Acts 1:8 that they were to go out and witness for him, to tell about him. And Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians 5:18 that God has given the church the ministry of reconciliation. Now, let me say something. One day while I was on vacation, I posted something on Facebook that I think offended some people. That was not my intention. But out of all of the fun stuff that we try to do, and I posted, what good is it to have a fall festival? What good is it to have something in the spring? What good is all of the stuff that most Methodist churches do if we never bring up the name of Jesus? If we never seal the deal by at least trying to invite them to church, we have all this fun stuff, but evangelism becomes like a secondary thought. That should be our primary thought, church. Otherwise, the community just thinks, well, that's a really friendly, active church. And guess who gets the glory? We do. I was talking to, I'm a leader of a circuit group of pastors, and we met here this past Tuesday, and we talked about that very thing. And we talked about how we're really good, you know. The pastor down at Christ Central talked about what they did. Bellevue pastor talked about what they did. Some others mentioned. I mentioned what we do. But we all agreed on the same thing. We're great at outreach in Methodist Church. We just don't know how to lead people to salvation anymore. And that's scary. Don't get me wrong. I thank God for all of you who have come from other churches to be part of this church. But most of the growth, if you check our history, has been through that. We make very few brand new disciples for Jesus Christ. Thirdly, our church exists to nurture new people, to help them, to teach them about Jesus Christ. We have to teach them more and more about what it means to follow Jesus. Now, Jesus spent a whole lot of time teaching. If you read the Bible, he taught people a whole lot. And Paul even mentions that that is something that is very important. He said, let the words of Christ and all their riches live in your hearts and make you wise. Use his words to teach and counsel each other. So, folks, the Christian church is supposed to be teaching. We're supposed to be learning to help us grow. But, folks, one of the things we should be doing is learning how to go out and make new disciples. And that's why I've stressed evangelism since I've been here, why Ken Durbin talked that class nearly a year ago. Because, as I said, we're great at reaching out, but we're not very good about winning new disciples. So let me just kind of recap this real quick before I move on. So we've established that Jesus loves this church, and he died for this church as well as all the others. We have established that this church is the bride of Christ that will one day get to join Jesus, and that we're the body of Christ, and that we have been given the work of outreach, witness, which is evangelism, and nurture, which is helping the people to grow. But for this to happen, we must have people who are willing to sacrifice. Take your out this thing again. What does our vision statement say? We desire to be a church where everyone is actively committed to leading the next generation into a life-transforming faith. I want you to think about that for a minute. For all too long, our denomination has accepted the idea that we want to be served rather than to serve. We will pay people to do ministry in the church because we want to be able to come in. I told y'all this is not going to be an easy one. And sometimes it's just like that. I'm not trying to hurt people's feelings, but I just got to tell you what's on my heart. We want to pay people in our churches to do ministry so we can show up on Sunday morning and leave and forget about it for another whole week. We need people that will step up. Since the pandemic, it's like this has become more pronounced in this church and other churches because people don't want to sacrifice their time and effort anymore. They want to go and do what they want to do, and they don't want to give up their time to teach or to lead or to help. Folks, we need people in this church to come up with new ministry ideas and see them through. I was talking to these pastors the other day, and they're talking about all these new things. All of these new things they brought up, do you know who came up with them? Who executed them? Not the pastor. Not in these two churches. They got some things happening because the laity are grabbing hold and doing more and more of what I've told used to happen here. If we want our church to grow and to make disciples, a man can't think of it all. It has to be all of us. And we've got to be able to have people that are willing to sacrifice, and we've got to have people who are willing to learn. What do I mean by that? Todd Till with the attitude of sacrifice is that we've got to have people who want to grow in their faith. We need people. I just wonder, I know you get tired of hearing about it, but folks, it's coming like a freight train, and you cannot stop it. This denomination is going to split. Just a fact. But how many of you are investigating it? How many of you have taken the time, there's a lot to read, so that you will be informed about what's happening? How many of us take the time to learn more about God? How many of us, as soon as this service is over, will make a beeline out the door and we won't be seen in this church till next Sunday because we don't take the time to go to Sunday school class or be committed to the Bible study class? And yet we get frustrated because we don't know about stuff. Folks, we also need people to step up to the plate. Now, if you've ever watched baseball, you can understand this metaphor. A batter can practice all day long, but if they don't step up to the plate, that funky-looking shape where the batter has to stay, do is swing the bat back here, but they never come up to the plate, they'll never hit the ball. Well, the idea here is you gotta take responsibility. Folks, 2 years ago, we had a great guy who, because of some things going on in his life, can't do this anymore. Used to show up early and turn on all the heat, make all the coffee, make sure all the chairs were set up. And also, when service was over, all the coffee pots were off and cleaned up. All the doors were locked. All the heat came back down to a temperature because, after all, gas prices are going up 50%. Now, sometimes on Monday morning, I'll come in here. The coffee pots will still be on. The heat's blaring. It's 70 degrees. Doors could be unlocked. Lights could be on. Because everybody thinks, well, somebody else will handle it. Folks, we need us all to be involved. Greeters. We have a problem sometimes with our greeters. We set up a thing here and wanted everybody, if you're a greeter, to be here 30 minutes early and to make sure you greeted people. And if they were a visitor, you really want to make sure they're a big deal. But sometimes we got our greeters, and I'm not saying all the time, but some of our greeters don't show up till 10 minutes before service. Now, y'all can say, well, OD's just fussing. You're fussing. I'm just telling you, y'all, it's not my responsibility alone to try to keep this church going. It's all of our responsibility. And the time for using COVID as an excuse is over. It's time that all of us who physically can to step up to the plate and become the church that Jesus wants us to be and to be proud of. So, the question for all of us is, are we willing to sacrifice and step up to the plate, or would we just prefer to, you know, come on Sunday morning, do our thing, and go home? It's your decision. But remember, Jesus died for the church. And that is us. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that your Son, Jesus Christ, gave his life for the worldwide church, but Lord, also to the group of Christians that are part of this local church. Forgive us when we shirk our responsibilities and just think church is showing up on Sunday morning and forgetting it the rest of the week. Lord, you have called us all to be responsible for growing the kingdom, inviting the people to church, sharing the love of God, and speaking the name of Jesus. Forgive us when we have not done so. And give us the courage and the determination to do so. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm just going to say this, if there's anybody here that would like to come and just think about your own relationship with Christ, or maybe if you just need to pray for forgiveness, or maybe you feel like God's telling you that it's time for you to do more, the altar's open. If you don't need that, that's between you and God. But if he is telling you something, we should react to it.
Power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Chain, break every chain, break every chain. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
Folks, so a couple of things I'd just like to say real quick. In response to what I preach, what I would appreciate is if you're not involved either a Bible study or Sunday school, that you make a commitment to do that this week. That you would make a commitment to speak the name of Jesus to somebody this week. And that you would make the commitment to begin to think about new ideas that we can do to reach out and get people to know Jesus through this church. Because you know what the Bible says about us? It says that we are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a people that have been called out of darkness and into the light of Christ. And so therefore go and be that priest this week. Amen.